Okay. We're going to see that usually a lot of SAR images are processed together or to better improve the solution, but it's also important now to study the evolution, the deformation over time of a given zone. So we're going to see what is a time series analysis in SAR, from my knowledge. Using more images is a strategy to obtain a better solution, to remove, for instance, digital elevation error, model error, when you don't have a good digital elevation model, or otherwise to have a more phase unwrapping, and you reduce some error, like the atmospheric error, as we have seen yesterday. And there are two different, these are the most used approach for this type of problem. One is based on persistent scatter method, that it was the first one method used, and the other one was a more baseline method. And you can also use combined method, and also this method can be used in different ways, it depends of our approach. So if you remember, today we are going to speak a lot about time and geometrical correlation, because if you remember, we have we have to compute interferometric phase. So we take images from two different acquisition points. and as if you remember, and these are two different acquisition points are separate, the distance between these two acquisition points are called baseline. And we have seen yesterday that in a lot of the formula that we have seen, this component is important, especially the perpendicular component. For instance, when we're going to compute a digital health model, to compute the height and so on. So this quantity is important. And we are going to see that in these techniques we have to take into account for the correlation in time and in the coherence of the images in time and in geometry. We are going to explain that. So, okay, this is some word. These techniques was found by Politecnico of Milano, is covered by a patent and so on, but it's not important now. These techniques use points that present a very high temporal and geometric correlation. Means that are points that I can see even if in SAR images that has been taken very far in the time. We see that there are some points, some signals that is still present over time. So it means that this object don't move or don't change over time. So a tree is not a permanent scatter, it's not a good, it doesn't present a low temporal decorrelation because it changes over time, it grow up, the leaves and so on. And this point present also low geometrical decorrelation, so it means high geometrical correlation. So it means that even if we take the picture from two different acquisition points, so the geometry is changing. The look angle and the geometry is a little differences. And this point, the scatter, the back scattering of this point doesn't changing this a little this geometrical configuration. With a change a little with the incident angle of the illuminating signal. So in general, our stable object are the roof of the flat roof, for instance, of an industrial building, or some metal surface, or also some rock formation. We are going to see. So you can find a lot of this point called permanent scatters that are point with low temporal decorrelation, low geometrical decorrelation, especially in the city. These are some example of permanent scatters. So usually are artificial surface like a building, like a guardrail or pylon and so on, but could also we can also use some natural element like rocks, big rocks and so on. So we have seen that when the signal arrives, we obtain a back scattering from the ground, and all this back scattering contribute to the pixel of our image. If in this, so this is the phase, this is the acquisition over time. So we have a very noisy signal. But if you have a permanent scatter, I mean a point with a strong back scattering, and a back scattering that is quite constant over time, you see that the phase is most stable. We have not all this big variation in the phase. So we have seen that we can put together all these images and process this over time, looking at the differences over time in the range. So for instance, at time t1, t2, we have the first deformation, and it corresponds to a different in the range in along the line of sight. In the other interval of time, we have another deformation, so another difference in the range between the two images. So we can build like a inside time series report that correspond to all to these differences in the range length. Okay, this is an idea what is a permanent scatter. We are going not to see the algorithm because I'm covered by patent, but also because it's not important now. It's important to know what is a permanent scatter, because often you find this information in the paper. To increase the temporal and spatial resolution of an area, you can also use artificial reflector. It means that you can build some special instrument that have a very high radar cross section. It means that are optimized as a scattering. It depends our study to optimize the signal, and you can find a different type of corner reflector are called. For instance, some years ago I was involved in this experiment, was in Milan, with some corner reflector. They studied this corner reflector, and was on a moving base, and we put also GPS antenna that is moving together with this corner reflector, that you can see we have two corner reflector in a different position. Why we have these two corner reflector? Two, no one, and in an opposite direction. Because if you remember, we have an ascending images and descending. So one was optimized for the ascending orbit, the other one for the descending orbit. Was really an experiment, and there was another couple of the instrument very close. And okay.
Excuse me.
Yes.
They must be at a certain angle.
The angle is this angle, you say, the inclination is put in this experiment in this period. If I remember, there was a radar sat. Yes, radar sat satellite. So was the orientation of this corner reflector was to be optimized with respect to the look angle of this satellite, of this system. And these are the results for the descending and ascending orbit. Here they put just the INSAR displacement and with respect the two movement. It means that one people move this instrument without give us the information of the quantity that they move, and after we check, it was a blind experiment, and after we check the precision for SAR and with the, and for GPS, and it was a good agreement. But I think that this was a very optimistic experiment, because it was in all was really in a good condition. We have a very two couple of corner reflector very close, so you can remove the atmospheric effect in a very good way, and so on. So I found another result with corner reflector. Yes.
So in this experiment, ground truth is the measure of
it's ground truth is the movement of this base that okay. is the really the true movement.
Okay.
Okay. In vertical and horizontal, if I remember, and yes, it's compared with the movement
estimated with INSAR.
Yes. Here I found another experiment with compare the with the Envisat permanent scat corner they use Envisat satellite signal and the corner reflector, and compare this data with the leveling. Leveling is the most precise method to measure differences in height. Okay, it's most precise, it's depend. Okay, the instrument can give you also 10^-2 millimeter of precision, so very high precision. The problem is that if you have to measure the differences in the height between very far point, you have to repeat the measure many times, and the error increase for the propagation of the error. You have to sum your error for each differences, the high differences. So at the end, you don't have this very high precision, but is the most precise method to measure the height. And you can see there is a good agreement, but if you look at the scale, okay, these are millimeters, so it means that sometime you have some millimeter of discrepancy, to be honest, over time. And I, no, just is like Okay, with GPS we try to don't say we have sub-millimeter precision, but we have in the estimate of the velocity of a point, we have this type of precision. With SAR, the people say we have sub-millimetric precision, also me in the paper. But I think that it's not, is a overestimated precision of the SAR. When for in this experiment, I think it's quite, you see, from this point and this point, you have 2 millimeters. And sometimes the discrepancy are more than 2 millimeters. And
but at least you can say that you have a centimetric precision, because it's in within the centimeter is obvious, centimeter is good in good
agreement. Yes, but centimetric precision, of course. The problem is that usually you want to say you want to have a more precise result, not only centimeter but millimeter precision, especially in the height, because a lot of phenomena are very slow. Okay, landscape are very fast and big with big movement. The volcanoes are have a very big deformation in the height. But for fault analysis, it's better to have very a smaller precision. So, but he said to say it's just to say we can improve the precision putting this corner reflector. Of course, we have to make this, and you have to spend money for this and so on. But the techniques works also without this corner reflector, using natural or natural artificial. It means the roof of the building object corner reflector. Now I found that also this technique has been improved, but I don't have an idea. So now they use a different technique, but I don't have idea of the differences. So just to say, also in this technique there is a development. Small baseline method is another approach. It's another approach that the key point is a coherence. We have to combine different SAR image to compute our interferogram, and the approach to do this is use more orbital separation with the distance between two acquisition time have to be small, and short time interval, because we expect that the situation doesn't change between one acquisition to another acquisition. So to reduce all the correlation. So if you have, for instance, this is a plot with temporal baselines, the distance in time between one acquisition to another acquisition. This is a perpendicular baseline, the distance between two acquisition point, and in terms of the perpendicular baseline mean, you remember these values. And you see that if these are, okay, these are the fourth master acquisition. If you have all your SAR acquisition, you can combine these SAR images in a different way. You can use a consecutive interferometric pair. Okay, for instance, these are very close in time, but quite distance in, with respect to these values, the perpendicular baseline. Or you can compute all the interferogram using with respect to these master images, but you can see that at the end you have a very high, very long these images is very far from this in terms of time. Or other one, you can use this more baseline interferometric pairs. It means the method used by these techniques. It means that you are going to compute the pair using divided the acquisition point with respect to the perpendicular baseline length, and computing this using the temporal baseline, for instance. So it's another approach where you try to maximize the temporal correlation and the baseline length. So you want to have more correlation between the images, and there are different approach. So you don't look for a permanent scatter, but just where the images has been taken in the acquisition time as the acquisition point. Yes.
What do you mean by the temporal baseline?
Temporal baseline is the interval between one acquisition to another acquisition. Okay, was using this plot. It's not my plot. It's a plot. I think that I take by the presentation of our associate professor from China. So this temporal baseline is a distance, is a time interval between one acquisition to another acquisition. So just to say, it's another type of approach, and I think that the two approaches give more or less the same result, or it depends on the zone where you are. Do you agree? I think that the two approaches give more or less the same result. It's a different philosophy in the data, or probably it depends where you are. If you are in zone with a lot of permanent scatter or not. Permanent scatter is a PhD work is on SAR. And if you are in a zone in the city, you have a lot of permanent scatter. When you go in a rural zone, sometimes you have problem to identify this permanent scatter. So
because of the time variation of the objects, yeah?
Yes, and you don't you have a lot of vegetation, yeah. So it's difficult to find an object.
In my opinion, depends also to the satellite orbit.
Okay.
If it's stable, mm-hmm. You have a small baseline, perpendicular baseline, mm-hmm. So you can use the first two units high and mid. When the baseline is too high, you can use consecutional images because there is two differences. So you have the obligated. Use the most baseline sunset algorithm to join the images and have a long time series. The noise inside because of the baseline is too high. So to reduce the noise and see something, you have to use the last missiles.
Okay.
My opinion.
No, I think that there are different schools, like to say it's better Bernier software or GAMI software. I think that at the end probably they give the same result, apart for a special case where you have probably one method is better than another one. Of course, if you don't have permanent scatter, you have to use this method, of course. And I think that I don't have an experience on this. So I think that at the moment we have finished the part of the SAR. We are going to see some SAR mission to understand better, to have more information. So do you remember, we start from radar. Radar give us is the core of the system. But the radar system have a too high, too low, sorry, this is not important, so I skip this slide. So the radar have give us a low resolution in the azimuth, so it cannot be used for this type for to have a geometric information of the Earth, to produce a 3D model of the Earth surface. So we can use a radar introducing a synthetic aperture radar. Synthetic aperture radar, I'm going to do a scheme. Combine different radar. Because combine different acquisition point with radar, rather to have a unique images collected by a synthetic antennas, mean a radar antenna in different position. We have seen that in this case we really reduce the resolution in the azimuth. But when we see the images, especially the face images, we have a lot of noise. It's like a random images. So to reduce for this noise due to the different scattering effect, we have to compute the interferogram to produce an interferometry SAR. So we use at least two SAR images. And we use two SAR images and we compute the interferogram. How we combine these SAR images is depend, of course, by this, for instance, by this consideration. If we have permanent scatter, of if we use this small base approach, small baseline approach, sorry. And when we compare in SAR over time, if we have an interferogram at time one and another one at time two, we can compute differential interferometric SAR. This is a use for the this is a use for the physical application. It's used for digital Earth model and so on. Yes.
Yeah, I was thinking, this is a simple question, more a curiosity. We said yesterday that the SRTM missions have two antennas mounted, so that they have a fixed baseline. And that's a good solution because you have like a fixed baseline in real time, basically.
Yes.
And for all the radar missions, why they didn't decide to mount on the satellite every time to
I don't know.
I mean, it could have been, I mean, simplification for many type of approach.
Yes, I think that it's more difficult to control and to put in
orbital.
We're going to see now that is a very strained instrument with a very long beam with another antenna.
It's not easy from engineers.
I think so, because it was a very strange mission with a short lifetime also. Probably it's not stable orbit with this type of, because if you know, the satellites are quite compact also in this shape. So to predict the orbit, I think that this was the problem, because shuttle mission was quite old mission, and with the Sentinel they don't repeat now that probably the technology is improved, but they use another approach. So this is for deformation, of course. Okay, so every time we have a deformation along the line of sight, as we have seen yesterday. Okay, have you got any question on this part at the moment? Of course, you can contact me. in the next day. Some years ago I found this picture, but probably now it's not really updated, but I show you the first mission for SAR measure, Earth-1 and Earth-2, after RadarSat, EnvySat, and so on. Now we are here and we have the most important mission at Sentinel for the European Space Agency, because they provide high quality data with high quality and free data. These are there are some information about when the time of the mission, and an important parameter is the period. Period mean when we have another SAR images, when the satellite came back over my land, my zone. So you can see that for the first mission we had a long period. Ah, sorry, it's Italian day.
Okay.
Giorno, esatto, sorry. Okay, after I'm going to check to correct. It's the first time that I received. Day, sorry. After I'm going to correct. These are the frequency used. We have seen that we can use signal in the XOC band, and this changes the wavelengths of 3 or 6 centimeters. There is also the polarization of the signal. You know that the electromagnetic wave has a polarization. And you can have a vertical polarization, horizontal polarization, so on. It's important, the polarization. We don't talk about this, but it depends in some, for instance, to do measure on sea, you need a type of polarization. To do measure on the ground, on the land, you need another type of polarization. So it's important, these values. And the different agencies, European Space Agency, Italian, German, these are some.
Sir.
Yes, I put other. Yeah.
So what is BS? Is that BS? Or is
V, vertical, horizontal?
Yes, H, horizontal, V, vertical. You have
a. BS means vertical, horizontal, polarization.
Mm-hmm.
Polarization means making all the plane of vibration in a single plane, yeah? No,
yeah, it's the way the electromagnetic.
Vibration of the particle, electromagnetic, yeah, in a single plane. So your particle horizontal means in two planes. So
but because the electromagnetic wave is being by the two field, electric and magnetic field. So we have the polarization.
So yeah.
Electric is
in
vertical.
Yes.
Magnetic and horizontal.
Yes.
In the case of VH or HV.
Mm-hmm. Do you see the Maxwell equation? We have the two components. Okay, these are other mission. I change the probably if another information. I change the table. I put the name here and the property in this. But it's not so. It's just to say you some information. Ah, these are the antenna lens. This is important because at the beginning, do you remember, for radar to have at 100 meter azimuth resolution, we need antenna with 100 length. But we see that usually we have 10-15 meters of antenna length. These are the altitude of the satellite, and usually are around 500-800 kilometers of altitude. The resolution, okay, these are big resolution. Now we have a higher resolution, means that in terms of meter we have lower values. But we are going to see in detail now. These are shuttle missions and for the United States and okay. Some information.
Antenna length is in meter or?
What?
Antenna length is.
And is the physical antenna length, the actual. In meters, yes, in meters. Yes, in meters. Like, yes, I didn't put the unit, of course. Yes, in meter. And. Okay, we have seen that we have our satellite and it's moving in the azimuth direction and send signal in the range direction. Almost on the satellite can work in different way. In a scansar mode, it means that they cover a very wide area in the a big swath area in this direction. Of usually they work in a strip mode, producing strip on the ground with a narrow wide. And they can mode also in a spotlight mode, looking at more or less the same point or the same point for a long time. And okay, this is the most used mode. Okay, no, it's just to say it's changed the resolution that you can have. You can observe strips or white area or spot mode. It depends on the system. Scan area, you have a lower resolution in terms of pixel, but you cover a big area. Or for special case, you can work in a spotlight mode. But in this case, you don't cover the hazard area, so it's a very special case. Okay, we're going to see better with the Sentinel mission. S1 or S2 was the first mission, and this is the time, and we have quasi polar mission orbit with a repeat time of 35 days. Okay, and it was working in C band. This is a images of the satellite. We have the SAR antenna, the radio antenna. There was also a radar altimeter to measure the sea surface height, and other instrument to laser retroreflector to compute the position to track this satellite from the ground, and so on, solar panel, and okay. As an instrument, with S2, the European Space Agency organized also a tandem mission. It means that the orbit of the two satellites was planned to be very very close. So. At least for nine months, and during this time we have a shorter time distance in between one image to another image. So we can, if you use both the images together, you have a high temporal correlation.
Yeah.
Because the distance was about 24 hours.
In time.
In time, yes.
So,
yes.
Time distance is. But the time period of the satellite is it the time period of the satellite 24 hours?
No, the time period is 35 days, but the Earth one come and the other one arrive after 24 hours, but the period was the same. Are very close to satellite, so they pass over land with a delay of 24 hours. So you they are very time correlated, the two images. Okay, this is not important. Not so important. We another mission was Envisat. Okay, just some information. Not so important. More or less the same day period. So on. Radarsat, UC band. Okay, I try to. I run to arrive to the most important mission. Okay, TerraSAR is a multi-mode sensor. It can use in the three modes that we have seen before. So you can see that when you use in a spotlight mode, you can have also resolution up to 1 meter. With strip map mode, you have a resolution up to 3 meters. When you use the system in ScanSAR, you have a higher resolution. So it means that if you increase the zone that you are going to measure in one time, the resolution, you have a lower resolution on the ground. It means that a pixel represents a bigger part of the ground. Okay, Cosmos SkyMed was an Italian mission from the Italian Space Agency. It was specialized for the Mediterranean basis, and also this mission can work in the two mode, in the three mode, sorry, in the multi-modes, and so on. Now we are going to see the SRTM Shuttle Radar Topography mission. And it was a USA mission. We have this is a shuttle, you know, the shuttle, the images of this shuttle is used to put in orbit a lot of satellite, and this is a very different from the other satellite, for instance, from the Earth One satellite, very different shape. In this satellite, we have an antenna here and another antenna with a baseline of 60 meters, so very long. And this antenna transmits data and receive data from the ground, and also this one receive data. So the baseline is fixed and is a single pass mode. It means that we have a very is in the same time, and we don't have different acquisition point. And okay, it's across the track. It means the orientation of this with respect to the orbit. Okay, why is this mission is so important? Because this mission lasts just 11 days. The goals of this mission is cover all the Earth to produce a new digital Earth model for all the Earth. It was the first digital Earth model obtain that cover the 80% of the land where the 95% of the people lives. They don't collect data in the polar region. I think that are related to the orbit of this satellite, but for polar region, there are other
satellite
mission to produce data. And for instance, in Antarctica, we have data from BedMap and so other missions that provide data. And the resolution was of 30 for 30 meter. Okay, I'm not sure that these data are updated. It means that when they produce this digital Earth model, the best resolution was 30 for 30 meter, but it was not free. The free solution was with a lower resolution, 19 for 90 meter. Now I didn't check if they change the policy and give available also this solution. I have to check really, but you can find it in the website. The precision in the height is not so good, 60 meter, but for many applications it's really enough. 60 meter is a very big, this is a mean values, of course, so sometimes it could be better, other times not better, but in many applications it's really sufficient.
But for, if you have a cell of 30 meter per 30 meter, you have 60 meters of uncertainty in the vertical.
In the vertical.
It's like half of the cell, so I mean, if you have a 90 per 90 cell, it's okay, 60 meters is okay, it's acceptable for my application. But if you have a smaller cell, you want to see smaller objects, smaller areas, 60 meters maybe is
too much. It depends on your application, to be honest. If you do,
for example, for gravity correction, the near field, no, but yeah, but in the far field, but in the near field, close to the point, If you 16 meters is for example free air correction is 0.3 per 16 meters, so you have 4 or 5 milligals. Could be relevant actually this.
I think that the hypothesis that you do in a topographic reduction are so high because you fix the density values and it's not really a big problem. This is a mean value. It's probably you have zone with a higher precision and zone with don't
lower
have because it depends also if you have data in a country to check your result and to fix the things. But in many application is a good solution for the land, and if you see into the topographic correction, you really do a lot of approximation, and of course also in the height. But
you can use LIDAR.
Yeah, in fact, you use it for near field.
LIDAR, if you use a short part, because if you have two computers.
Yeah, no, but that's
yes, but be careful from my point of view, because sometimes you really have to check if you have really a difference in this or not. I think the problem are more when you. Okay, for instance, the gravity correction, yes, there is this problem, but what you don't correct in a proper way, you can obtain with a collocation or a least square, or fast Fourier transform when you are going to estimate the last part of the gravity field, for instance, joint computation, and so on. So you have to check. In many applications, it's really enough for this type of precision. In a Bouguer reduction, for instance, to invert gravity data, okay, the precision are kilometer when you invert the data. You say, okay, MIMO discontinuity could be here, but the differences are some kilometers.
But for example, if you have to do because from gravity you can calculate estimate the mobile, okay, you have long wavelengths and precision up to kilometers. But if you have, for example, to do gravity modeling of residuals. That's you have you are in the order of 10 milligals, and actually for yeah for let's say restricted areas, that could be a factor to consider. So if you have 60 meters.
Okay, for my experience, it was enough. Okay, I think that we have to check to do. Is one of my future tasks. I want to check this different quality in terms of joint computation, for instance, because we have a topographic reduction. But I think that I don't remember this color land, probably are also okay. I don't remember this line one, this different color. This is the precision in the eye, the mean values put together or the word. Probably in lot of parts, this difference is really better. Because, for instance, for okay, when you have a digital terrain model, at least the first, just a moment, this is the. The differences in the resolution. Before we use this digital Earth model for the Earth and the same zone with the SRTM. So you really improve the quality of the resolution of the digital Earth model. Another thing, when you. When you at the beginning, when you have the first release of SRTM digital Earth model, you have a lot of gap, especially in the mountains. You don't have sea, so you have to have a complete bathymetric topographical digital Earth model. You need also to have information from the bathymetry. So we have to fill this gap introducing a bathymetry model. And also in the mountain we have a lot of gaps, at least for Italian, because it depends on the look angle of we have seen yesterday. We computed digital Earth model with the ascending orbit, another one with the descending orbit, and after we combine the digital Earth model. Some gap can be present, and we fill this gap. We validate this digital Earth model, and okay, if also we use a digital Earth model obtained not with the LIDAR, because we don't have a LIDAR digital Earth model for in the past, now probably yes. For Italy, we can use this to fill the gap, and we don't found so big differences. So it means that probably in our country, the precision is better than these values.
Yeah, it could be interesting actually to make, because if you have 30 meters per 30 meters DTM, it could be used like, and it's homogeneous over the entire country. Would be actually useful to do topographic correction, not in the near field, I mean in the far field. Mm-hmm. It's good enough for the 90 per 90 meters.
Mm-hmm. Someone from the UNGO made the Team Italy. It's a digital elevation model of 10 meter resolution.
Yeah, I think I saw it, but I don't know.
I use it in the thesis.
Yeah, I saw it, but when I read about it, I couldn't understand actually which data you was mixing to make this. I have difficulties with the
counterpoint and interpolation.
This mission was playing before the LIDAR period, epochs. Now with the LIDAR, it's a system for your, is a system that you put this laser system on a airplane or a drone also, and a flight, and have a very high precision, is a centimetric precision. And but is more expensive, it depends. In the past, to have digital Earth model, we use photogrammetry. We took images from an optical sensor, photogram, and uses the stereoscopic theory, we are able to produce a 3D model. But it was a very expensive technique, so because you can fly just in some period of the year, at least in Italy, in summer, in the late summer, and because the problem has a shadow, the clouds, so you cannot fly. Otherwise, you have all the picture covered by clouds, and the shadow of the tree, of the building, and so on. So you have black in your picture, and you cannot correlate two images, because to have a stereoscopic view, you need two picture. It's like our eyes, to have the three dimension view. To see the depths, we need to use two eyes. Otherwise, we cannot. We lose one dimension. And in our case, the mind can correct this because we know what we want to see. But with the images, you can see that just using one images, you can just find the position, but not the height. Can be translated, because for the collinearity equation you need at least two images. Okay, after the photogrammetry there was this mission that give us a lot of information, so the people start, because the photogrammetry was really expensive, to use this type of expense in terms of time and money, but especially in terms of time, because you have a few days where you can really fly and cover a country, and you also have to perform topographic survey on ground using GPS or using theodolite and so on, or leveling. So it was really expensive also in terms of time. And so with this mission was really expensive, of course, because it's a satellite mission, but in 11 days they obtain all the data. They spend a lot of months and year to process data, but the data are already collected. In the 2000, more or less, it was developed this technique called laser scanning or LiDAR, and it's used special for local application, because you fly with usually with a airplane, not a satellite, or now with drone, and you have a very high precision. So usually any Italian region start to do LiDAR flight to produce new cartography and so on. So the resolution is very high. But I repeat, it depends on the precision that you really need. Okay, if you are going to do some hydrological study on of the river, and you have to check the river or some other things, so it's important to have a technique that you can repeat in an easy way, and you have a high precision. But otherwise, really, it depends, because it's expensive, a lot of data, and so on. So you have to. So you probably in many applications, SRTM digital terrain model is good enough. If you since what happened in other part of the Earth, we did a lot of computation with a very low resolution in the digital terrain model. Now, yes, so it depends on what you want to study. But this was a really important mission. Copernicus Sentinel. Okay, the last part of the course. The European Space Agency has a program called Copernicus on the observation of the Earth. In this project, there is the planet to put in the orbit five or six, the last one is called also JSON, with another satellite, sorry, Sentinel 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. To observe the observation of the Earth. Sentinel 1, it was a planet for a star measure, and they used two polar orbiting satellites with the C-band and with the orbit period of 12 days, so we really reduce the period with respect to S1. Sentinel-1 will work in a pre-programmed operation mode. So we have seen that we have a spotlight mode, scan mode, strip mode or scan mode. And some system can decide, okay, now I work in one mode or another one. Sentinel can use different mode but are already planet. So you cannot switch. European Space Agency, could you do a mission for 10 days in a spot mode because I am interested in this part? No, it's already planet. To avoid conflict and to have a consistent long-term data archive, because it's important to have continuous data archive to do time series analysis to really follow the process in the time. Okay.
Orbit period should be 6 days.
I find
because
this information
they
in the
sat. Sentinel-1A. That.
Because we have
twin satellites.
Yes.
And after in 2018, the Sentinel-1B, that is run after the 1A, so they 6 days for returning the same point.
Okay, and I found this information
in the previous graphic with all the central mission, there is Sentinel-1A,
Sentinel-1B. Yes, I know. I don't know, I found this information in space, probably it's better, I don't know. Sorry, this is a refuse. And okay, so it's really work in this different configuration. It's a really planet to collect data in a different way, but are already programmed. They don't change, for the user. And so you can see that you can have a very high resolution of 5 for 5 meters. And different polarization for instance, this one is used for polar environment, sea ice zone and so on. This is used for the other land, okay. And so, it has been planned to work in this way. So there is also a period of 25 minutes to be that respect to collect data for all. Okay. Now it's more complicated, so sorry, forgot this. Okay, this is the geometry. So you have strip mode and you have the different resolution with respect to the. Yeah, with respect to the Italy, just to show you have a representation. Okay, for me it's not so important. Two satellites in a 12-day orbit. Repeat frequency, this for probably is a repeat frequency 6 days. No, I don't remember this part, sorry. Is that a repeat frequency? I don't remember this. I'm going, please, you can check in European Space Agency website. I don't remember this, why I put this one. Okay, don't forget this. This is an example of Cosas make interferogram for the 2016 Central Italy earthquake, and you see a very big the quality of the data that we obtain, the deformation in the Central Italy obtained with the Sentinel 1. Okay. Copernicus Sentinel 2, okay. Copernicus Sentinel 2, I put this to be clarified that they use a multispectral instrument. Multispectral instruments is another type of remote sensing technique, but it's used to have land monitoring, not in terms of movement, but in terms of thematic monitoring, to produce thematic map of the Earth, to control the artificial surfaces, the area covered by forest, and so on. Multispectral use a radiation of the ground to study the physical property of the Earth, and obtain information about the agricultural area, and so on. And it's also used for emergency and other type of study. But it's not SAR mission. It's a don't confuse these two mission. Okay, some references that you can use for the SAR part, and you can find a lot of information in the European Space Agency website. Apart from this document, you find really a lot of information. Okay, I finished. I hope to have some minutes for your question or your information about the exam.